Section 1.4 is bias in studies. There's only two objectives in this section. The first one is to define bias, and the second one is to identify sources of bias. Objective 1 is to define bias. We'll start this by looking at what an unbiased study looks like. Imagine that you were to draw a simple random sample of students to estimate the percentage who are Democrats. By chance, your sample would probably contain a somewhat larger or smaller percentage of Democrats than the entire population of students. However, imagine drawing many simple random samples. Some would have too many Democrats and some would have too few, but on average, they would balance out. On the average, the percentage of Democrats in a simple random sample will be the same as in the population. A study conducted by a procedure that produces the correct result on average is said to be unbiased. Now imagine that you tried to estimate the percentage of Democrats in the population by selecting students who attended a speech made by a Democratic politician. On the average, studies conducted in this way would overestimate the percentage of Democrats in the population because you would expect people that have a Democratic-leaning political philosophy would attend a Democratic politician's speech, whereas fewer Republican-leaning students would attend a Democratic politician's speech. Not that that's a good thing. It's always a good idea to see what both sides are saying. Studies conducted with methods that tend to overestimate or underestimate the true value from the population are said to be biased. So hopefully we have some general idea of what bias means now. Objective 2 is to identify sources of bias. The first source of bias we're going to look at is something called a voluntary response bias. A voluntary response survey is one in which people are invited to log onto a website, send a text message, tweet, or call a phone number in order to express their opinion on an issue. In many cases, the opinions of people who choose to participate in these types of surveys do not reflect the population as a whole. In particular, people with strong opinions are more likely to participate. In general, voluntary response surveys are highly biased. You may be listening to a radio DJ talk show and they solicit their listeners to call in and express their opinion, and you may have an opinion about the topic of discussion, but you just don't feel strongly enough about it to call in. Does that mean that your opinion's not valid? No. It just means that you're like most Americans that are busy and involved in their own lives, and they hear something about this and they go, "Yeah, it's not that big a deal to me. I'd rather stay driving safely in traffic and not make that phone call." Another type of bias is self-interest bias. Many advertisements contain data that claim to show that the product being advertised is superior to its competitors. The advertiser, however, may not report any data that tends to show that the product is inferior. For example, an advertiser for a car can say that their car gets 20% better gas mileage than the nearest competitor, but they don't tell you anything about the competitor. People who have an interest in the outcome of an experiment have an incentive to use bias methods. Another type of bias is social acceptability bias. People may be reluctant to admit to behavior that may reflect negatively on them, which affects many surveys. For example, a pollster may ask, "Did you vote in the last presidential election?" The problem with this direct approach is that people are reluctant to answer no, because they are concerned that not voting is socially less acceptable than voting. Another example of this is if a researcher wanted to know what percentage of the population of college students is having unprotected sex, and they go out to a college campus and survey people by walking up to them and looking them in the eye and asking them, "How many times in the last month have you had unprotected sex?" Because it's not socially acceptable to have unprotected sex, most people will lie. However, if you pose the same question in an anonymous situation where people know that their answers can't be traced back to them, they would be more likely to tell the truth. By looking somebody in the eye and asking an uncomfortable question, you could introduce social acceptability bias into the results of your survey. Leading question bias. Sometimes questions are worded in a way that suggests a particular response. Consider the difference in the following questions. The first question is, Do you favor decreasing the heavy tax burden on middle-class families? Who's going to say no to that? Of course, we favor decreasing heavy tax burdens on middle-class families. Families shouldn't be taxed over heavy. Another way to ask that question is, what is your opinion on decreasing taxes for middle-class families? Choices are strongly disagree, somewhat disagree, neither agree nor disagree, somewhat agree, and strongly agree. This is a more neutral way of asking the same question. Here, you've already introduced an emotional feeling by saying that the tax burden is overly heavy on middle-class families, and that tends to prompt a particular response. Another example of loaded questions would be the following. When asked, should the president have the line item veto to eliminate waste? 97% of the people surveyed said yes. The reason they said yes, most likely, is because of this that I've underlined, eliminate waste. Who doesn't want the president to be able to eliminate waste? However, when they rephrased the question to, should the president have the line item veto or not, only 57% of the people said yes. Hopefully, more people realized that our government was founded with this three branches of government and a system of checks and balances so that not one individual person has too much power. By giving the president the ability of a line item veto, yeah, they may use it to eliminate waste, but what if the next president comes along and eliminates something that you want? For example, tax cuts. You've got to be careful whenever you're asking questions and make sure that the questions are not loaded. Whenever you're reading scholarly research, quite often in a complete write-up of the research, they will give you the questions that were asked so that you can read those questions and then make your own determination about whether or not you thought those questions were loaded. Another potential pitfall is the order of the questions. Questions are unintentionally loaded by such factors as the order of items being considered. Here's a question that was posed in a study. Would you say traffic contributes more or less to air pollution than industry? That sounds like it's a neutral question, and for the most part it is. However, the results when this question was worded this way was more people thought that traffic contributed to air pollution. But when we reversed the order of traffic and industry, we got very different results. Here, 57% of the people said industry contributed more. Probably what's going on is when people hear a question, their mind grabs onto the first thing they hear, and so that first thing that they heard is the one that got the largest percent. This is easy to counteract. If you're surveying 100 people with this question, what you could do is pose this first question to 50 people and then switch the order on the next 50 people, and that should dampen the effect of the question order. Another type of bias that's a real problem, especially in qualitative studies where you're sending out surveys, is something called non-response bias and sampling bias. People cannot be forced to answer questions or to participate in a study. In a study, a certain proportion of people who are asked to participate refuse to do so. These people are called non-responders. In many cases, the opinions of non-responders tend to differ from the opinions of those who do respond. As a result, surveys with many non-responders are often biased. Sampling bias occurs when some members of the population are more likely to be included in the sample than others. This occurs naturally, which is why whenever you're doing any research, you don't want to rely on just one random sample. You generally want to do two or three random samples and then look at the average values for those random samples. Here's a white paper on how to handle non-response bias. This is a live link, so if you want to click on it, you can. As you can see, this is quite an involved paper if you were to click on the link. Non-response bias is a very big problem, and one of the first things they suggest in this paper is hit the pavement, go out and find the people who didn't respond to your survey, and see if you can convince them to respond. That's the easiest workaround, is to get non-responders to respond. This paper actually goes beyond the scope of this course. It delves deeper into the problem and how to fix it. Because this is an introductory level course, I just want to make you aware of what the different types of bias are. If this were an experimental design course or a course that focused solely on analyzing data and designing experiments, say a graduate level course, we would actually start looking at these different ways of handling the non-response bias. At the end of this section, you should know the difference between a biased and unbiased study and the various sources of bias, including all of these that we just looked at. And this wraps up section 1.4.